Okay, well, this first code snippet doesn't assign streams at all. So none of these operations declare a stream, and therefore they're all in the default stream. And since they're in the same stream, each one must complete before the next one in that stream is allowed to run. So CUDA memcopy will run for 1 second, kernel A will launch and run for 1 second, and CUDA memcopy will run from another second. We'll copy the memory down, do some operation on it, copy the memory back up. And after 3 seconds, the results will be ready for the host. This next code snippet does declare a stream. It puts them all in S1. And so, since all three operations are in the same stream, the previous operation must complete before the next one can start. So once again, this will take a second, this will take a second, this will take a second, and the final result will be ready in 3 seconds. This one's a bit more complicated. Here I'm doing two operations on different chunks of memory. So I'm copying HArray1 into DArray1, calling kernel A on DArray1, and copying DArray1 back to HArray1. And then I'm copying HArray2 to DArray2, doing some operation on DArray2 by launching kernel B, and copying DArray2 back to HArray2. So the first three operations are in stream 1, so CUDA memcopy async will be called, and it'll start a memory copy to happen on the GPU, and then CPU execution will continue. The next statement will happen. We don't stop and wait for this memcopy to finish before we execute the next statement, which is a launch of kernel A. Kernel launches are always asynchronous, so in effect, this queues up the launch of kernel A, which will be run on the GPU after this memcopy has finished, and it proceeds to the next statement, which is another CUDA memcopy async, to copy the results of kernel A back onto the host. All three of these are in stream 1, so they will all wait for each other on the GPU, but the host just issues a command, issues a command, issues a command. It doesn't stop. It proceeds to CUDA memcopy async in S2, and so now it starts another asynchronous memory transfer. This one, because it's in S2, doesn't have to wait for any of these operations to complete, so it gets started right away. It'll complete in 1 second. It calls kernel B in one block of 192 threads, also in S2, and then calls CUDA memcopy async, again in S2, to copy the results back. So the first memory copy will happen. These next two operations in S1 will get queued up, and the next memory copy will happen essentially immediately. So in the first second, this memcopy and this memcopy will be running. In the next second, kernel A will be running and kernel B will be running. And in the final second, the return memcopy will be running in S1 and the return memcopy will be running in S2. And so the minimum amount of time this can take, if all of the operations that can run concurrently do run concurrently, will again be 3 seconds. But in this 3 seconds, we'll have actually gotten twice as much work done. We've overlapped the execution here. And I phrased this very carefully when I talked about the minimum time this is going to take. It's worth noting that there's a lot of reasons why it might not be able to overlap all of these operations. Some older GPUs can't do this many asynchronous memcopies at the same time, and I was pretty careful to launch a single block, so this probably will not fill the GPU. On the other hand, if kernel A had run tens of thousands of blocks, it might well fill up the GPU with those blocks before kernel B got a chance to start filling the GPU with any of its blocks. And so kernel B might end up waiting on kernel A simply because resources are not available to run it. The final example is the same operations, just reorganized. So in this case, we issue both memcopies in stream 1 and 2, we launch both kernels in stream 1 and 2, and we issue both memcopies back in stream 1 and 2. So rearranging these things shouldn't make a difference. The minimum time that this could take is still 3 seconds.